You know, we have been in a series talking about or answering the question, what on earth are we here for? And I know that that's a proverbial question that's been asked by the ages from all generations. Certainly, our young people need to know what on earth they're here for, as do all of us. And so we have been discussing that topic over the last few weeks, and we began by talking about worship. The primary or one of the least first purposes of your life that God created you for was to worship Him. You were planned for God's pleasure. And you know, God gets pleasure, so much pleasure, when we enter into heartfelt worship of Him. It is a joy to our Heavenly Father. And then our second purpose that we discussed was fellowship. We were formed for God's family. We were purposed to come together as a family and to worship God and to fellowship together. The third purpose we talked about, which was last week, was that we were created to become like Christ. You see, discipleship is what it's all about. After we come to Christ, after we get linked into the body of Christ through a fellowship of believers called the church, then we are on this lifelong journey of discipleship where we're created to become like Jesus, to take on His nature and His character as we follow His teachings. And today, the fourth purpose that we're going to discuss for our lives is ministry. You were shaped for serving God. Let's pray together as we begin. Heavenly Father, I thank You for Your word today. I thank You, Lord, for all that are here and that I'm here and that we're well enough to be here. And God, we pray for those who are not in the pews today, not in the seats. God, we don't know where they are. Some we do know are sick, and some probably are on the road traveling. But ultimately, Lord, we just pray that You'd put a heart in us that we desire You so much that any time that we can possibly be gathered together in a fellowship of believers to worship You, that Heavenly Father, we would have a heart desire to do that. But beyond that, Lord, as we're going to speak today, that we would have a heart for ministry, as we saw earlier in this skit, of these people who were called into missions, that we need to understand we are all called to spread the gospel. Whether it's as William Carey went to India or as John Doe went down the street from his house to share the gospel with someone. Father, that's what You called us to do. We were shaped to serve. Father, bless us as we open Your word today. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Excuse me. I want to begin today by drawing your attention to 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 5 and 6. And this is out of today's English Bible version. We are simply God's servants, it says. Each one of us does the work which the Lord gave him to do. I planted the seeds. This is Paul speaking. I planted the seeds. Apollos watered the plant. But it was God who made the plant grow. You see, God has called us all to be planters or waterers or nurturers. He's called us. He didn't just call preachers. He didn't just call Sunday school teachers or deacons or servant ministers. He called all of us to be hands-on in ministry. Every one of us. And if you're sitting there this morning and you're thinking, well, I really don't do anything in ministry. I mean, and don't get me wrong when I say this, but I'm a good person, and therefore everybody can see Jesus in me. Hello, it goes far beyond that. I'm glad that you're obedient to Christ. I'm glad you're serving Him in your personal life and have that relation with Him. But ultimately, the Bible tells us to go and to share the gospel. We are charged by God to do the work that the Lord's given us. You see, you were saved for service. You weren't saved for self-satisfaction. You weren't saved to be successful in this life. You were saved for service to God. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10 says, "For we are God's workmanship." Listen closely. "Created in Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do." You know, before God ever created the heavens and the earth, the Bible says, before there was anything, that the Lamb was slain before the foundation of the world. Jesus, it was already planned that He would come and die for our sins, everyone's sins. Some have told me, he says, well, Jesus may have died, may offer forgiveness, but he'd never forgive me because of what I've done. I am so glad Romans 5 says that God's grace is so much greater than all of our sin put together. He can forgive us and he will forgive us. But it's interesting to note that he prepared your good works on this earth for him. He prepared that before the foundation of the world. God has a time calendar, and it's not really linear as we think calendars, but I think it's more like a circle where God's in the middle and he can look at any part of that circle and see the now, the here, what's going on at this moment. John chapter 17, verse 4. These are Jesus' words as he speaks to his heavenly Father. He says, I have brought you glory on earth by completing the work you gave to me. Jesus said that. Jesus was assigned work. You and I are all assigned work from the Heavenly Father to be doing on this earth. You know, so many times we get wrapped up with, let's just face it, we get wrapped up with a 9-to-5, Monday through Friday, our jobs, our careers, our responsibility with children, family, home, husbands, wives. We get wrapped in that. But ultimately, although those things are important and important to God too, they're not our primary purpose for existing. Jesus said, I have brought you glory by doing what you told me to do. That's what I want to be able to say. When I stand at the judgment seat of Christ, because I am saved, God is going to stand me there and he's going to give me rewards. I'm not being judged for my salvation there. I'm being judged on what I did in the body, whether it brought glory to God or not. I remember one time, and I won't tell you where this was. It wasn't even in this country. But I was with a bunch of Christians. It was kind of like on a Sunday night. We'd come to church, and we were all standing around talking. I said, we all. We were all standing around talking. We was talking about fishing, and we were talking about football, and we were talking about all kinds of stuff. And then it was kind of like the bell rang. It was time to get into church. We all turn around, and all of a sudden, we're spiritual. Everything's about Jesus, and it's all lovely, and we're worshipful, and we look good. And then we go back out, and we're all about fishing and recreation and what's going on in life. And you see, that doesn't bring glory to God. He gets glory from our worship and our praise and our adoration towards him. But ultimately, God has given each of us an assignment in life. And I dare say multiple assignments, because sometimes he wants you doing this and you shift gears and now he's got you doing this and then he'll have you doing something else. It reminds me of the woman that was sitting on the piano bench in the church, and the new pastor came up to her and said, wow, I just found out there's another lady in the church that plays wonderful piano, and I would like to have her have an opportunity to play too. Maybe we could do, let her play an invitation, or maybe the music on Wednesday night, and you know, you keep your prominent spot there on Sunday morning. She looked at the preacher and she said, nobody sits on this bench but me. This was in the church. Well, the new preacher, in his wisdom and youth and vitality and somewhat stupidity, said, well, okay, then you just move and we're going to put her in here. And so she got offended, but you know, God got the glory. And anytime someone says, nobody's going to do this job in the church but me, we got a problem. Amen? We got a problem. But anytime someone comes in and says, you can't, you're sitting in my seat, you're sitting in my pew. You ever seen those pews got the name tags on them? Family so-and-so, this is the family pew. You don't sit there. It says Williams on it. Don't sit in the Williams pew because you're a Clark. Don't sit over there. You know, I've only been in a couple, only served in a couple churches that had nameplates on the pews, and if I'd had a hammer and a little thing, I'd have pried them off while they weren't looking. Because this is God's church. It's not ours. We don't buy places. God is no respecter of person. You come in, you're family if you're in Christ, amen? And if you're not in Christ, you can be family by just coming to him today and giving him your life, surrendering him to him. Your past has been forgiven according to Scripture. Your presence has been given meaning because God has a plan for you. And your future is secured because of what Christ has done. Therefore, Romans 12:1, therefore, I urge you, brothers, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God. Because of what Christ has done for us in our lives, he's given us forgiveness of sin. Not just the big ones, not just the past ones, the ones in present, the ones in future, all sin God paid for. And when I put my faith and trust in what Jesus has done on the cross, shed his blood, died for the sins of mankind, took on the sins of the world, then went and now sits at the resurrected, sits at the right hand of the Father, doing what? Playing tiddlywinks, doing checkers, chess. No, the Bible says he is sitting at the right hand of the Father in a position of authority, making intercession for you and I. That brings comfort to me. Because I know I'm not there yet. I have not attained. Paul said, I have not attained. I might be close to the finish line, but I've not attained yet. And neither have I. And so I am so thankful that in my weakness, in my failures, I know Christ is interceding for me personally. And I need it a lot. How about you? I need God interceding for me because I am weak and frail. And although I am all powerful in Christ, in humanity, I'm weak and frail. Romans 12:1, I urge you in view of what Christ has already done for you. In light of that, looking at that, understanding the gospel, understanding that Jesus has died and paid your sin debt, it's only our reasonable service, as the King James says, that we should offer ourselves as living sacrifices. Because you were saved for service, you should use what God has given you. And some of you may think, okay, what did God give me? Everybody take a deep breath like this. Inhale. Exhale. Number one, you got life. Amen? Use it for the glory of God. You say, I don't know how to preach. I don't know how to teach. I don't know much Bible. I stumble a lot. Use what you have for the glory of God who has given you what you have. And develop what he's given you. Don't just take it and say, well, God gave me the ability to comfort somebody, so that's what I am. I'm the comforter. Let it grow in your life. Become not a comforter, but the comforter. Do all you can do. Romans chapter 12, same chapter, verse 5 says, since we find ourselves fashioned into all these excellently formed and marvelously functioning parts of the body of Christ, listen to what it says. It's out of the message. Let's just go ahead and be what we were made to be. Let's just be the church. Instead of doing church, instead of going to church, let's be the church. Let's go out of these doors and do the sayings of Jesus. You know, the Bible says, don't just be a hearer of the word, but be a doer also. Doing does not save you, but if you're saved, you'll be doing. Amen? God has made you unique for the purpose that he's given you in the body of Christ. You're special. Nobody else can do what you're doing exactly because God gave it to you. Now, you may come together with what you have and somebody else something similar and work together as a team, and that's great, and we should do that. But you're unique in God's sight. He put you as a hunk of clay on that potter's wheel. He got that thing spinning, and he's still spinning you, amen? And you're going round and round. Every once in a while, he finds that lump in the clay, and he picks it out, smooths it over, starts it again. That's called sanctification. That's our daily walk with Christ as we grow in this world. You should be actively involved in ministry, doing the Lord's work as every opportunity presents itself. You know, I went to a place over in Gulfport, met with some preachers a couple of weeks ago, and they had a speaker in, and the speaker said something that just stirred me. They said, this is an opportunity that we have and we can employ if we want to. And I thought, that might be something Grace Chapel can do. And then I went to a preacher and wives conference retreat up in Tennessee last week, and it was a fly trip. But anyway, we got one good day right there where there was no rest. It was just all conference. But a lot of things were said and a lot of opportunity was brought to surface. And I'm thinking, Grace Chapel can do that. We can do that as a body of Christ. We may not be able to get a large mission team and send them to Tanzania or someplace on the other side of the world, but let me tell you what, we can go down our street to the school here and try to get involved. We can go up the road someplace in a community and try to get involved. we can fill up the baby bottles that are on the back table there and help the crisis pregnancy center. We can do other gifts and send them overseas to help children in an orphanage in Uganda. All of these kind of opportunities keep popping up, and I'm saying, God, show us what you want us to do, and pop, 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 like popcorn. Y'all eat popcorn? You know what it does in the bag? Pop, pop, pop. These are opportunities God's giving us. And I'm thinking, Lord, in the last 2 weeks, I've gotten 4 new opportunities for missions for our people, for our church. You don't know about them yet. I haven't even shared them with you. But I'm going to. And what I want you to do is pray and say, God, what have you got for me to do? And you know what I'll spit out something. I'll say, well, what about doing this, about helping this orphanage, these children of Uganda? And someone will think, well, somebody else will do that. That's just not I don't feel like that's my cup of tea. Hello, God isn't serving tea. He's giving out assignments. He is not asking, he is commanding. Amen? This is not a smorgasbord or a buffet. You go up and you just kind of pick and choose what you feel like you want. This is the gospel of Jesus Christ, and God has called us in Matthew 28 to go, to reach out, to go to every nation, every people, whether it's up the road or across the world. We're to go, and we're not. Listen, the word go is an imperative. And the subject there, which is unwritten, is you go. You go into all the world and share the gospel. Well, sometimes we can't physically go to China or we can't physically go to South America, but let me tell you something. We can put money in that baby bottle right there and send it to the Crisis Pregnancy Center in Picayune. We can do some of these other opportunities that are surfacing right now, and I'm investigating to see which ones God really wants us to do. And when I bring them to you, let me tell you what I expect. I expect you to say, wow, Brother Stan, I believe God's putting that on my heart to get involved in that. How can I help? Not I can do this or I can do it. How can I help? Tell me what to do, I'll do it. That's what I do with God. God, tell me what to do, I'll do it. That's the way we respond to God's commands. There's a Danish proverb, it goes like this. What you are is God's gift to you. And what you do with yourself is your gift to God. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 15 says, do your best. You see, we come to church and there's things to do, there are opportunities, and we say, well, I'll teach that children's class. Then do your best teaching that children's class. We say, Brother Stan, there's only 2 in there right now, and sometimes nobody shows up, and that's discouraging because I've spent hours in the week getting this lesson prepared, and then no children show up. Be faithful. Be faithful to do what God's called you to do. You say, well, Brother Stan, you know, I'm in the music ministry. Be faithful with it. Say, Brother Stan, well, I don't teach and I'm not in the music and I don't do children. What should I be doing? I don't know, but you need to find out. Don't you? Can I get an amen? Amen. We need to know what God's calling us to do. And so my job as a pastor is to find these opportunities God lays in my lap and present them to you so that you can listen to God and say, God, oh, wow, I hear you speaking to my heart about this. I don't know how to do it. I don't know what to do. But God, I'm available. It also says in 2 Timothy 2:15, do your best to present yourselves to God as one approved, a workman who, listen, does not need to be ashamed. When I stand before God on Judgment Day, I don't want to say, well, you know, God, I just was kind of busy when you called me to do that. Amen. We're going to have to give an account. But we need not be ashamed of one who correctly handles a word of truth. What is a word of truth? God's word, the Bible. How do we handle it? We apply it correctly. We interpret it correctly. We use it correctly and don't twist it to meet our agenda in life. Since we are God's servants, I want you to look how real servants act. In Mark chapter 10, verse 43, out of the Message, it says, whoever wants to be great must become a servant. How many of you know that? The Bible says that. You want to be great? Be a servant. Well, I really don't have this goal for greatness at all. I've never really in my life thought, well, I want to be somebody. I've always thought in my life, God, can you help me get through this day? You know, it was kind of like that. But if you have a desire to be somebody, if you want attention or whatever, then what's this Bible say? God's the one who gives it to you. You don't want it from other people. What's good is an attaboy or a pat on the back from your neighbor? Or what's better, approval of God? Matthew 7. Look here, Matthew chapter 7. I got three verses, 16, 21, 24. It's on the screen. Matthew 7, 16 says, you will recognize them by their fruit. Now, he's talking about false teachers here, but it goes the same for Christians. You'll know a Christian by their fruit. The Bible says you'll know the brethren by the love they have for one another. But I'm going to tell you something. Who produces the fruit? Good Christians produce good fruit? No. Christians are fruit producers because the Holy Spirit is in them producing the fruit. Not you and me. The Bible doesn't say we do that. The Bible says the Spirit does that. But He lives in us, and as we yield our lives to Him, the Holy Spirit produces positive, good traits through us. You want to look like a Christian? Then don't act like yourself. Submit yourself to Christ and allow Him to be illuminated through you. In verse 21, it says, Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the ones who do the will of my Father who is in heaven. You see, there are people who go around, and in the Bible we can see this, there are people who casting out demons. And they're not going to heaven just because they cast demons out. You see, you don't go to heaven because you cast demons out. You go to heaven because of the blood of Christ and you put your faith in what He's done. Then, if the Holy Spirit wants to cast a demon out of somebody using you, that's fine and wonderful. However, I don't suggest you look forward to that day. I've been there a time or two. It's not a happy place to be. But it's rewarding in that you know you were used by God and you see the results. The person comes to Christ when the demon is gone. The Bible says, when a demon is cast out, that if there is not something to fill the void, i.e. Christ, if that person does not accept Christ, then in the Bible, the illustration given in the account of the Bible says that one left, he was cast out, the house was swept clean, but nothing replaced it. Nothing replaced the presence. The Holy Spirit wasn't there, and the demon and seven worse than the first one returned. You talk about a mess. Let me tell you something. It's Christ in us that keeps demons from entering us. Demons can oppress them. We can be troubled by them. They can aggravate us sometimes. But they cannot come into us because the presence of light expels the presence of darkness. Amen. I thank God for that. So don't be worried about getting demon-possessed or something if you're praying for somebody like that. The truth of the matter is, Jesus is bigger than all our fears. So not everyone that says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but who? The ones who do the will of my Father. God has given us a mission, a purpose, a plan, and we need to follow it. Verse 24, it says, therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice, who does them, doesn't just hear them, but does the word, is like a wise man. You see, real servants make themselves available for ministry. You make yourself available. You don't just say, well, I got a little free time, I'm available. It's not the way God works. God says, I'm looking for servant ministers who make themselves available. You put on the back burner other things, maybe things you want to do, to make yourself available to serve. Real servants pay attention to other people's needs. How important is that? You look at the homeless driving down the road. Diane gave out a couple of homeless bags the other day, last week or so. And then we were up in Tennessee and we see a homeless person. And first thing she said, I don't have any more bags. I gave them all away. I don't have homeless bags. The ladies of the church have put together some homeless bags. You don't have one, you need to ask. But if they don't have any, go make your own. Amen? What is stopping you from doing it yourself instead of waiting on some team or committee or group to put it together for you and hand it to you? Step out. by faith and do what God has called you to do, that you know to do. Real servants do every task with dedication. And real servants are faithful to their commitment. Let me tell you something Johnny Hunt shared. He was in another country. I don't remember what it was. African country, I believe it was. And he was going to preach, and he was telling them what he was going to be talking about. He was going to be talking about commitment, which we need to talk about, by the way. He was going to talk about commitment to these people in this foreign country who were coming out of the villages going to hear the gospel. He was going to talk about commitment. And the the interpreter said, "We don't have that word in this language. We don't have the word commitment in this language." And he says, "Well, what have you got?" And he says, "We don't use a word like commitment. We use the word, listen to this, surrender." Surrender. You know, how often do we say, well, and let me tell you, the biggest problem I see in the church today is lack of commitment. Doesn't matter whether it's here in Tennessee or overseas. Lack of commitment in the lives of Christians. It's the biggest problem I see. He says, we don't have that word commitment. We have the word surrender. Can you see the application here? Maybe they got it right and we got it wrong. Maybe we need to be talking about surrendering our lives completely to Christ, and we will be committed. Hello? And real servants, listen, elevate others above themselves. Elevate others. Matthew 10:42 says, if you give even a cup of water to one of the least of these followers, surely you will be rewarded. We also need to think like a servant. We can act like a servant, but we got to get it right up here. Real servants have a servant mindset. They think more of others than themselves. It's all about self-denial. It's about self-sacrifice. You see, those two are the core of servanthood. If you will not sacrifice, if you will not get self out of the way, and it's all about what I want, and you know, God's been dealing with me about this. And I was looking at something. I'm not even going to identify what it is. Diane doesn't even know what I'm talking about. But I've been looking at things and thinking, wow, that'd be nice to have. Anybody on that page? That'd be nice to have. I would like that. And then what's next? Start trying to figure out how you can get it. Well, let me tell you what Jesus told me. He says, you can look at that all you want, but you need to have the mindset of a servant who sacrifices. And so as it goes by now, as I see it from time to time, I think this. I think, you know, I could buy that. I could afford to buy that thing that I'm thinking about. But what if I didn't? Listen to me, church. What if I didn't? What if I chose not to satisfy what I wanted and I decided to take that finance and put it into missions? To send it to Uganda, to the orphanage, to send it to Greece, to Joy, who's over there working with refugees, or to just put it in some kind of mission, local missions or associational missions, or the Siemens truckers in missions here on the Gulf Coast. There's all kinds of places I could put this money that God is showing me that if I would just sacrifice and not grab hold of what I could grab hold of. You see, it takes surrender. Much more than commitment, it takes surrender, doesn't it? Philippians 2:4, it says, forget yourselves. This is the Message Bible. Forget yourselves long enough to lend a helping hand to somebody else. The Message interprets it, well, you don't have to deny yourself all the time, so to speak, but you have to deny yourself enough so that, you know, you can help somebody. Jesus didn't say, I don't ever want you to have a new car, or I don't want you to have a house, or I don't want you to have a TV. Jesus said, deny yourself to take up his cross and follow him. And how if we do that Sunday and Wednesday, amen? That's not what the Bible says. Daily. Do it daily. Godly servants think like stewards, not like owners. It's not that I own anything I have. God's allowed me to have it for this time and this place, and I'm thankful for it, but it's not mine. And so if somebody needs something I have, I shouldn't have any reservation. If I want to, just give it away. Just give it away. I know there was, after Katrina, there was a family in Florida, and they called me up, and they said, and I got this through a second person, but the bottom line was, they said, we have a vehicle we want to give to the church so you can give it to somebody. They could have sold it for about $3,000, and they said, we just want to give it to the church so you can give it to somebody. Doesn't it feel good to be able to do that? Now, it may not be a $3,000 car, but you may have a something here. It's worth $25. $25. And you're thinking, wow, I can save that and I can use that. What if it's a gift certificate to one of the restaurants? $50 gift certificate. And you're hanging on to it, and you see somebody and you say, you know, I'd just like to give this to you. Well, it just cost me $50, right? No, it didn't. God gave it to me to share. And we need to have a self-sacrificing attitude, mindset, to be a servant of God. Luke 16, chapter 13. No, let me get this backwards. Luke 16, verse 13. No servant can serve two masters. You've heard this before. You cannot serve both God and money. Jesus spoke more about money than he did heaven or hell. But when the preacher talks about money, people start saying, well, I ain't going to talk to church. All he ever talks about is money. Hello, I'm acting like Jesus. Sure is quiet in here. Servants think of ministry as an opportunity, not an obligation. Not an obligation. You know, when I hear about a program where we can get into the schools and touch the lives of children on elementary level, or when I think about a need in Uganda that I will never know these people, never see them, but I find out there's a way that I can help. When I get information about the Holt children that we support, three of them in this church, and I find out if we just throw our pocket change in and get $30 a month, we can support a child. And we're supporting three of them through the efforts of this church. So we want to keep on doing anything that we can, any place that we can. It doesn't have to be a big thing. It doesn't have to be a giant mission trip. It can be those little things, because you are responsible for whatever opportunity Christ has given you. Oh. One's attitude towards money reveals one's submission or rebellion to God's leadership in your life. Your attitude towards money, towards finances. Hebrews 6:10 says, God is not unjust. He will not forget your work and the love you have shown to him as you have helped his people and continue to help them. So don't think that just because nobody gives you that pat on the back or that attaboy, that God is not paying attention to what's going on and what you're doing. Furthermore, God is the one who shaped you for service, so you can be confident that when you go, you're going in God's power. Oh, that's comforting to me. So comforting to know that when I go to do missions, or I go to do a mission effort, or I sacrifice something to give to others, that God, I'm doing it in God's power. Do you think God's going to reward that? Do you? Hello? Yes, he is. And someone said, well, it's not going to be in this life. It's going to be in the life to come at the judgment seat of Christ. Christ's going to give me all these rewards. Yes, he is going to do that. But let me tell you something. God has blessed me so in this life. If I never got anything else, I have received much more than I've ever sown. And you cannot sow in Christ without reaping a harvest. You plant seeds, and what's going to happen? They're going to come up out of the ground. Well, there may be an exception to one or two of you that kill everything that you touch. But most of us are we going to get something out of the ground when we plant it. And when God's in it, you're always going to get something out of the ground. 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 4, in the last part of that, it says, yet by God's power we will live with him to serve you. By God's power. You're able to be effective in your service only because the operating power of the living God in your life. This does not apply to non-Christians. They can do the same thing you're doing and not do it in power. It's not as effective. 2 Corinthians 12:9 says, I am with you. And I like what this says. This is out of the message. I am with you. That's all you need. That's all you need. My power show up best in weak people. Ah, I should be really powerful. Amen. And you are powerful when you surrender to Christ on a daily basis and allow Him to lead and direct your life. You know, some of us get up on Monday morning and we're hitting it. We get up, we fly out the door, we go to work, we do a good job, we in and out all week, and then on Friday, whew, we go like this, we say, okay, God, you got the rest of the week. Well, except Saturday, because I got things planned on Saturday. I'll give you Sunday. Well, only Sunday morning, because I'm busy Sunday afternoon. Amen. You see what we do? And then we say we're surrendered? Come on. Let's be honest, because God knows, doesn't He? Your most effective ministry will come from your deepest weakness and some of your pain. That's where your best ministry is going to come from. So when you say, God, just don't let me suffer, don't let me hurt or anything like that, you're missing opportunities for God to show Himself as God. Philippians 4:13, everybody knows this. I can do all things through Him who gives me strength. I always quote King James. I can do all things through Him who strengthens me. Either interpretation, you get the idea. God will allow you to do anything He wants you to do because He is empowering you. Conversely, you can't do anything of eternal value without God's power in your life. Matthew 25:40 says, I tell you the truth. Whatever you did for the least of one of these brothers or sisters of mine, you did for me. You know, God has called us. He's equipped us. He's empowered us to do the ministry He's called us to do. So let me ask you the question. What excuse have we got for not doing missions? You were shaped for serving God. You were saved for service. You need to use what God's already given you. Don't sit here and pray, well, God, as soon as you give me the power or the resources, forget that. You say, well, I don't have the resources to sow financially into this ministry or that ministry. Give what you can. Let me tell you what, the Bible example of that is give until it hurts, and then you've actually given. Does that make sense? Because if I give out of my excess, what have I done? I've just given some excess, doesn't faze me, doesn't hurt me. There's no sacrifice there. But when I give of my time or talents or resources to the point where it's costing me something. David said, I will not come to the sanctuary to worship you, to offer a sacrifice that has cost me nothing. David knew this truth. Real servants make themselves what? Available for serving. They pay attention to people's needs. They serve with enthusiasm, commitment. Let me say surrender. They're faithful to their commitment, and they elevate others, not themselves.